Hello, and welcome to KDAB News, the monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Robert Brock, and in this edition, we have news, new feature, interview with Qt's chief maintainer, Volker Hildesheimer, Qt World Summit 2022, virtual and local, tip of the month, and announcements. With Halloween and the longer nights, we thought it good timing to add dark mode. This mode will add a spooky atmosphere for the 31st and will save your eyes on these cold, dark evenings. Now, to make that button appear, all you need to do is simply... A few months ago, Lars Noll resigned as CTO of the Qt company and as chief maintainer of Qt. I'm glad to talk to his successor, Volker Hildesheimer, today. Welcome, Volker.
Thank you, Robert. Nice to be here. Thanks for the opportunity as well.
For the first of our questions, how were your first months as Qt chief maintainer, and did the transition go well?
Okay, that's a good question. It's been a couple of months now. We had a good selection and election process as the Qt community, which I'm very grateful for that we could have this properly organized. There were a couple of discussions on the mailing list, perhaps. Regarding the process, because that's the first time we did this. So, figuring out a bit how we want to do this. And then we ended up with a decision just before summer, which in many ways made this a fairly smooth transition in the beginning, because, of course, summer, people were on holidays. I had time to get on top of some of the administrative bits and pieces regarding the role. I had time to reach out to all the maintainers, which was nice, just pinging them over email. How are you doing? What are your thoughts about what we are going to do next? And I think that there I got already good feedback, and people were grateful that, hey, cool, somebody's actually like reaching out. And I think some of the maintainers haven't heard from us for a long time, and the other way around as well. So it was nice just to get in touch. Getting on top of some of the administration, following up on some of the contributor summits discussions, which was also just before summer. Following up on those, and yeah, I think that dominated a bit the first couple of weeks and couple of months, and then starting the conversations around where we want to go anyway. That conversation still goes and still continues. It's not like we have a big vision document at this point as a Qt community, but that's also fine, I think. And then, of course, the first time I really went out as the chief maintainer and stood in public in that role was now at Academy in Barcelona a couple of weeks ago, which was lovely. I'm having that chance and that invite to keynote for the Academy crowd and for the KDE community. That was really a great honor and a good opportunity, and I felt very welcome there. That's nice. I haven't worked with the KDE community before much. I'm neither an active user nor an active contributor. So from that perspective, meeting lots of new people and discussing ideas and sharing our thoughts. So that was a very lovely event. Now it's a bit business as usual in many ways, as you know, the day is full even without being a chief maintainer. And some of the discussions on the mailing list, of course, still going on, and there will always be some of those. No big events, no big press storming the front door. Which is nice. And of course, Lars is still around. It's not like he's gone. He's still maintainer for Qt Multimedia and other things. He still cares and he still works on it. And we are close personal friends as well. So he's in Oslo. If I have anything where I feel that I need some input or some reflection from him, then I know where to find him. But that's nice. So all in all, no big traumatic chief maintainer kind of shock.
Excellent. So smooth transition overall. Are you planning any changes or novelties for Qt in the near future?
So in the Qt project, I don't think as the chief maintainer or of the chief maintainer as like the benevolent dictator that has a big vision and now that I'm in charge, I can finally do what I always want to do. That's not how it works and that's not how it should work. I think the maintainers are running a very steady ship around their respective modules, which is great. I'm very grateful that we have a fairly active and competent, extremely competent community of maintainers that does that. Reaching out to them and asking what they are planning, there are no big surprises. There are no big, oh, finally, we can start discussing this thing. Of course, there are a couple of discussions on the mailing list, which some of them show us very clearly that we are not done ever with Qt and with Qt 6, and there are still things that we would like to fix and where we need to invest into making things ready for the future. But I don't think that changes, as in let's really do things differently now from a technical point of view, is what the framework needs or what the project needs. I think stability, predictability is what is the most important thing right now. Qt 6 is only 2 years old. Customers are still in the process of coming over, and there are still a couple of things missing. And I think closing that gap and enabling that transition is the most important thing we can do right now. So changes, as in let's redo this part of Qt, or let's re-architect certain aspects. Not really, not unless there is really a very good reason for it, and then do it very carefully so that the transition and the adaptation can be smooth. I think there are a number of things that we would like to do, and that's maybe something we can discuss later in terms of how we operate as a community regarding changes. But at least from a technical side, I don't see much. I do think there are lots of novelties. That was part of your question, right? What news? What new ideas? What innovation is coming? I think there's lots of stuff happening, and there's lots of stuff happening in the industry that we operate in. That is extremely interesting and relevant for us. And some of them are very buzzwordy, perhaps, but things like WebAssembly have a great opportunity or a great potential for being quite disruptive to how we, as a software engineering community, operate and work. And I think it's great that we are on top of that with the Qt project, and also things like what's happening on the programming language side. I mean, we are a C++ shop traditionally, and people think about Qt as primarily a C++ framework, perhaps. And then there is QML, where we are still doing a lot of interesting things. And I think there is still a lot of room for us to be innovative and make it easier. But also, if you think beyond that, 2022 has been the year of the C++ successor language, right? A couple of proposals have been made, and a couple of projects are flying around now. And I think that's interesting for us. What does that mean for us? And also, of course, what other languages are there? The problems that we solve with Qt are not C++ problems. Everybody that works on developing software has perhaps these problems in one way or another. And there are plenty of languages out there that don't come with a good user interface programming framework. So Python has been a great success for us in the terms of getting more eyes on Qt and having more people use and think and know about Qt. And there are other languages out there that have the same problem, that they are very popular as programming languages, but don't have a very convincing user interface. And so, I think there are lots of innovation ideas or opportunities for us as a Qt project to reach a lot more people with what we are doing. And with QML, also we have, I think, on the technical side, a lot of good stuff in our hands to be able to say, let's people that are developing Zig applications, let's have them use Qt for the user interface with QML and Qtpic. You know, why not? So I think there are cool things that I think we are going to see, even though none of them right now are naturally work in progress as such. But yeah, don't know if that answered your question, but here we are.
Yeah, that certainly answers it. A great answer. And finally, it looks like external contributions to Qt have decreased over the past years. Do you have any plans to encourage the community to contribute more again?
Yes. And first of all, we have, as a big step, hired our new community manager, Pedro, not that long ago, beginning of the year. And he has been looking into how we are doing things and what the situation is, and has a lot of good ideas, I think, on how we can be more proactive and more inviting to more people contributing to Qt. And of course, also a bit thinking about contributors as more than just the people that are committing patches to get it, right? Code contributions are important in many ways, but they are not the only way. And I think we are very biased towards those people that actually contribute to Qt on a coding level. People that discuss Qt, think about Qt, share what they have been doing with Qt as open source projects. Also just, you know, feedback via bug reports, all of that is contributions. And I think if we look at this total number of people, then the community has definitely not become smaller. It has become more active. They have, like I mentioned Python earlier, we have reached a lot more people today with Qt for Python than what we had 2 or 3 years ago. And from that perspective, I think the contributions come in different ways. And in total, the volume is not going down. It's rather going up. There are a couple of things where I would definitely like to see more contributions, especially also to the code, of course. We have constantly this question, okay, what are we doing for the desktop? What are we doing for certain platforms? Well, I hope that people that feel strongly about Qt being also successful and up to date on desktop, mobile, and so forth, which hasn't been until recently a priority for the Qt company, that you know they find also that they feel or that they find themselves invited to participate. And of course, we have lots of customers that are using Qt and would like to have a more immediate, perhaps, impact on where we are going with the framework, and helping customers, helping users to contribute to Qt also on the code level. I think that is definitely something we should look into, and I know that Pedro is thinking about that. So from that perspective, yes. Also having, as a community, perhaps a more open culture is maybe the wrong word, but we tend, I mean, as Qt company employees, we are in our comfort zone and discussing with each other in the hallway if we are together in the same office or on our company internal channels. I think making it easier for us to bring the technical conversations into the public and inviting more people to those conversations, that is to some degree a bit of a question of habit, and it's also a question of IT, because the conversation in the Qt community about what we should use instead of IRC, I think, is as old as the Qt community. So from that perspective, maybe, hopefully, at some point, we can come up with a solution that makes it easier for us to have an ongoing and continuous conversation around certain things that we would like to work on, inviting more people to be part of that conversation, and not have to wait for that once-a-year contributor summit, to bring all these issues up. But rather, okay, if somebody is working, if we are saying let's work on this particular API in Qt and discuss different designs and architectures, I hope we can find a way to do this more in the open and invite more people to join that conversation and feel more a part of that. So all of these things, and yeah, again, Pedro as our community manager, pulling a bit strings and coordinating the activities around these different topics. I think that will help. But yeah, it's work.
Right. So a few things are cooking. Excellent. Good news for the community ahead then. Thank you, Volker, for your time and enlightening answers.
Thank you.
This year, the Qt World Summit will have a new format. The main conference will happen online on the 9th of November with lots of talks in four different tracks. One for people new to Qt, one for more experienced, one for tooling, and one for the decision makers. Check out the KDAP talks by Nuno Pinheiro about designers in the development cycle, and Jesper Petersen with a best of from his Qt widgets and more series. In addition, there will be several local in-person events across the US and Europe, with selected talks among them by KDAP speakers about the new Rust bindings for Qt. Come and meet us there, it's free. And of course, we are happy to sponsor both the online conference and the local meetups this year. When writing C or C++ code, profiling and debugging is one of the crucial tasks for any developer. The first thing you need to do is make sure your code is properly tested. This in itself is not debugging, but it enables you to make sure that you don't introduce three new bugs when you fix one. Never happens. Another thing that is quite related to unit testing is code coverage. You want to make sure that you have a sufficient number of unit tests and that they cover an important percentage of your code. Something else you can do is static code analysis. The goal is to have bug detection without even running the application, simply having a tool that looks at the code and tells you where there's a construct or pattern that might have a bug. The most well-known debugging technique would be printf or equivalent. Some logging of messages for figuring out which function we're going into, what is the value of this variable, and so on. Then there are assertions, tracing, debugging, and so on. The tip of this month is a comprehensive blog post that gives you a quick overview of all the tools available for those tasks, like Squish Coco, Clazy, or for introspection of Qt apps, Gamma Ray, just to name a few. Read the full article via the link below. And, by the way, if you want to be updated about our blog releases and other publications, please subscribe to our monthly newsletter. We promise not to spam you. It's just one email per month. That's all. Just a reminder that in a few weeks, Meeting C++ will happen in Berlin and online. The program offers a rich variety of talks over 3 days, including one by our colleague Ivan Cukic about error handling in C++23. It will cover what STD expected and similar types are all about, and how they can be used for unified error handling. Check out the full schedule below. And later in November, there will be QtCon Brazil from the 21st to the 26th. The program is in the making, and there will be a keynote by Till Adam from KDAB. The website isn't updated at the time of this recording, but we'll add the link below as soon as it is out. Save the date and check it out. Thank you for watching. Stay safe, and of course, feel free to share any feedback or questions below the video. I'll see you next time.